Well, hello there, ladies and gentlemen. Are you ready to rock? Welcome back to yet another Offstage with DWP. Maria Brink of In This Moment is our special guest today, and it's your first Zoom call.
Yeah, I haven't done Zoom yet, so I'm excited. I figured it all out. I'm impressed, and I'm really happy to be here with you.
Oh, good, good. And well, again, under different circumstances, we'd rather see you on stage in front of 40,000 sweaty, drunk rock and roll fans going crazy to another killer In This Moment show, but we'll take this, right?
Right. I mean, I think all of us more now than maybe ever are just appreciating those moments that we have all had like that, you know, these, you guys' festivals and just all that energy of all those people celebrating like for music. And it's just, it's the best thing in the world. So I think this is a great time for us all to reflect on that. So when we get back to it, man, we are going to be so grateful. I think everyone is going to celebrate like they have never celebrated.
Right. Like we, any band, any fan does not take this, will not take it for granted.
Right. You know, exactly. And the crowds, I think everyone, I think it's everybody's outlet, like, especially in the metal world, like, it's where you're like, you know, like in my everyday life, I'm so sweet and I'm really kind and I'm one of those like peaceful, really, you know, and I get out all that like awe that I have, and all of that is through live performance, you know. So without it, you're just, you know, have a festering ball of fire.
I'm glad you brought that up. You really are a sweet person, but yet you enter a different portal or something. Somewhere between your tour bus and a DWP festival stage, you enter something else. What is that? I was joking before we started, you're drinking a glass, and I was waiting for kind of the smoke of, you know, the smoke to come out of the glass, some sort of magic potion.
I just start burning things. Yeah.
And like in a serious question, what do you do before in somewhere in between your that backstage room and that stage?
I start prepping, you know, a few hours before, and it's kind of like that, you know, prepping for your play music that kind of really just starts to get me into like a whole other energy and slowly start shifting. And then, yeah, something just happens, you know, when you go on stage, like I can let out everything, you know, all of my, especially because I said I am always trying to be the peaceful one and that kind of have that energy. That's where I get out all my like fire and my power, and like something transforms. It's like I stand different and I talk different, and it's like I'm taken over by something.
Yeah, well, because not to out you, but rumor has it more than once, and this is from our good friends in Skillet, John and Corey, the Coopers, who bring their family on tour. You have been seen at a DWP festival with their daughter playing with Barbies. Just so you know, that has been, by the way, it's freaking adorable.
I love that. I think it's so beautiful when you're out on tour and you see people's families with them, because everyone on tour misses home. So when people get to bring their family out with them, it's, you know, and they're all such kind, loving people, the whole family. So.
Oh, Skillets, they're incredible. Yeah. Like this, yeah. Perhaps the sweetest. Next to
exactly.
You know, Boat, the whole band, couldn't be nicer. And they too are such nice family people. And then they get on stage and they just rock out, and it's great to see. I want to take it back and kind of work chronologically with you. And again, we're off stage with DWP. We have our special guest, Maria, from In This Moment. So it's been 15 plus years as a band, right? And you and Chris are really the kind of the constants. You're the consistency behind the band. 15 years is longer than most marriages. So what is the secret sauce for that you and Chris have together as a duo?
I mean, I think through thick and thin, we became best friends too. Mm. So there was just, and we're family. Like when we're done touring and no more music, like, you know, we'll always be in each other's lives. He's my brother. So he became literally like my family. So we just have this dream together, and he always believed in me and I believed in him. And we just, you know, yeah, we fight together always. So I love him. And we're really lucky, honestly, with the lineup that we have now. we've had to shift a little bit here and there, and it's been kind of beautiful because we actually have got to work with so many wonderful musicians and had this different energies kind of come and go. But the people we have now, we've been with for a long time. We're lucky to have them. We're really excited. We all have good energy between us, and it's just really easy. And now more than ever, we're all grateful to get back together for music and to do some shows.
Yeah, so the Maria and Chris are, again, like you are since the 15 years. It's probably not an easy audition process for you to find a band member because they have to be great musically, but they can't, you know, look like Clark Kent either, right?
Right.
So there, is it a hard process to find that band unity over the years, or is it easier than I'm thinking?
I think in the beginning, when you start off working with musicians and working with people, I think you're a little bit more ego in the beginning. You're like, my band, and blah, 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 and you're more, I don't know. I think the more I've been in the band, the more we've just really chilled out and just love working with just really, you know, easygoing, good, just people who we consider our family. Travis, our bass player, they were all in bands before I was in a band with any of them. They all did music together with the exception of our drummer. So they were all kind of working together, and then I kind of came into the picture, and we had two different ones. So we've actually all been in the same music scene and known each other and loved each other. So it's really cool that we all got to then form who we are now, what we are now, you know. I think they're all really special, you know. They all have such amazing stage presence and strong, and they're good, really good men off stage.
That's probably important for you. I'd have to think that there's so many bands that we see in this moment not being one of them, or a Skillet or a Papa Roach, but they don't communicate. You know, some bigger bands even take separate buses to gigs. And the only time they see each other is when one's on stage right, one's on stage left, and away they go. And there's something that always lacks for me. And I've always found it disheartening when I see that. And it sounds important to you to, all right, maybe this guy's a dick, or this person I heard is one of my dancers. I hate her, but she's a great dancer. I don't think that applies to you, right? They have to check the boxes. They have to get along with you.
Yeah, I think that we have to just get along with each other. Just like good energy, good people, and just appreciate each other. You know what I mean? And we do. And our crew, like, our whole crew's out of work right now. It's crazy for us. We're doing a shirt for them, trying to help in different ways. But so many people are hurting right now, you know? So I think, again, you want to work with people that you love and people that you all feel good around each other. I don't want to be around somebody that bums me out every day.
Yeah. Well, you got to drive 6 hours from, Toledo, Ohio to Kansas City. Can you imagine, like, I would drive me crazy if I couldn't stand the person that I was spending in a bus for 6 hours.
Right.
I'd love to talk. Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
Don't judge me, but we actually are on two different buses. So you're saying that.
Well,
but it's not. I tell you what, I think everybody's different. And all the guys are on one bus, and I'm on a different bus with some of the women. And I think that it keeps us actually healthy because we're not on top of each other all the time. And I'm a very artistic person, and I'm kind of like a lot of the art director and a lot of things that we do. So sometimes I'm like, oh, and people just need a break from that sometimes. And I don't think that means that we don't love each other. I think it's just like a healthy kind of little separation. And then we're all around each other. We never fight. It's like, we're really healthy in that way. So, but in Europe, we always share buses and we get to have that whole experience. We all share the one very smelly bathroom.
I was going to say, one bus, when you're in America and you have two buses, I bet you, I know it's a generalization, but one bus probably smells a whole lot better.
Yeah, I mean, when I started, I was like in a van. So I did all the van touring, and we had our fake little booking agent. We made up our own name. It wasn't real. We were like calling, saying we were a fake booking. We wanted to book in this moment for $100. So, you know, things have changed, but I was in a band with all the boys, so I like paid my dues.
Yeah, no, you did. I'd love to talk about DWP and In This Moment's resume together is quite long, and allow me to indulge. Rock on the Range, 2012, 2013, 2015. Sonic Temple, 2019. Louder Than Life, 2017, 2019. Aftershock, 2014, 2017. There's four in Rockville. But the one that really kind of put you guys to the next level in our world was Northern Invasion in 2015. And I think, and maybe I'm wrong, but you guys used Journey, Don't Stop Believing. Did you start in 2015 with that as your intro music?
Yeah, we did.
Right, okay. Because we're like, what the hell is that? And it's so, and you guys were a step ahead of everybody because it was the loudest sing-along we've ever had.
People love it.
Right, like what's not to love? It's like, don't overthink things sometimes. But you guys used Journey, Don't Stop Believing. And then that show, that was our first year at that festival. And we had Carolina Rebellion, Rock on the Range, Louder Than Life, and Welcome to Rockville. We were introducing a new market. And the crowd, when we start a festival in a brand, in a market, is they don't get it first. They're kind of sleepy. They don't know what to do. Like you go to Aftershock or Louder Than Life, and they know crowd surfing, they know moshing, they understand what they're supposed to do to good music. You guys were the first band at that show, and this was later in the day. You guys woke that festival up and kind of saved our day. And I don't know if you remember that gig, and I'm going to put you on the spot. Is there one DWP show that really stands out to you?
It's the second time we played Rock on the Range. It was the first time we played was on like that second, and it was like a huge moment for us. Actually, my best friend's husband asked her to marry her on stage. It was like really special.
That was the third stage. I remember that. Yeah, we had three stages, and so I'm remembering now that what you're about to talk about.
Yeah, and then the next time we came back, we were on one of the main stages, and like something happened right there in our career. It was like a moment that we all had, and it was like Blood came out, and I think Blood was our album that really put us on the, but it wasn't just Blood. It was Blood mixed with the music video mixed with your festivals. Like literally, I think you guys helped like shape all like what happened with our band at that time. Cause we just had those moments in that show in particular where it was just like something happened with crowd and the way everything was just going, and it was like we knew something happened in our career. Like this is like, it was like a real moment for us. So we talk about that, and when I told Chris I was going to do this with you, and he was like, tell him how we talked about that after that. It was like a moment. I was like, I'm going to tell. It was special for us, and we had so many of those moments with you guys, because really those are the biggest shows of the whole year. You know, I think we all wait for those, and it's so exciting. And you guys help to really, I mean, you know, empower bands when you let them go in front of all those people. And we've been with you guys doing those shows for a while now. We're so appreciative. We love it. It's such an amazing time.
Well, the feeling's mutual, Maria. And I'm so glad you brought up that show. I believe it was 2013. And we rarely did repeats, but we heard about And that show,
yes.
and Chamey,
yes,
who's,
the next
Chamey,
year. Yeah,
somebody came to the production office and said, did you guys see what just happened? Because like, you guys had that moment, like you guys crushed it. Something did happen in 2013. I totally remember that now. And that was around 2012, I was off of 2012's Blood, which Adrenaline is always one of like the show stoppers at our festivals, as is Whore, but Adrenaline with that guitar riff. I want to give that, I have to assume that that's a Chris credit right there.
Yeah, him and Kevin came up with that.
Yeah, that's a riff that just never stops.
Yeah.
You know, and so.
My favorites, it is.
Yeah, I was, and would that be one of your favorites live?
Yeah, I mean, I've done it so many times, but yeah, there is always something that happens in that song. Like, it's just special every time. Like, just the way the energy feels in the room, something like it's special. So I love doing it, and it's empowering.
Well, you followed that up with 2014's Black Widow, and the song that really we all felt that took it to the next level, even after that great Rock in the Range performance, was Sick Like Me. I think that was also the time that we really started noticing your stage setup became more elaborate. You had choreography, you had actual staging and props, you had dancers. I don't mean this jokingly, but whoever wants to diss me what I'm about to say about Madonna or Lady Gaga, you can say what you want about their music, but if you haven't seen a Madonna concert or Lady Gaga, there's such an entertainment value that goes missing with rock. And I feel like you channeled some of that into your goth metal, into your alt metal. Was that by design, or am I just like, am I reaching?
No, I wanted to bring it alive in all those ways. And I'll never forget when I went to Chris and I was like, I want to have performers with me on stage. And he was like, what are you talking about?
Right.
And I told him I didn't want to have a handheld anymore. I wanted to have this one so I could dance and use my hands and, you know, like this. And he's like, what's happening? But then I just was like, you have to trust me. And he started seeing what we were slowly doing. He was like, I'm totally seeing what's happening, and he was totally all for it. But I just love performing arts. I love art in general. And I think if you can take music and you can keep it really raw and stripped down with just the musicians on stage, and I think there's a beautiful special magic to that as well. Like when there's no props, it's just like the magic of your eyes are closed and it's live and it's not even about the live show. Like there's something just as beautiful as that. Well, I personally wanted to really work with like bringing the music more alive on stage visually in all these different ways and these different perceptions and having all these multiple forms where we all look like clones. You don't know who's who. Like I love just bringing it to life and being unique and kind of trying to do something special.
Has Chris or anybody in the band seen a Madonna concert live or Beyonce?
I don't think they have, but they love all of them. They love all those women that you just said. They think they're, you know, powerful. I mean, people have had, even back in the day, Tina Turner had her dancers
totally
on stage rocking out. You know, I think that there's just so many different elements, and just even like just when I see performing arts and just certain visuals or certain things, like I think it's really cool to bring art alive in the visual sense too, if you want to on stage.
We're with Maria of In This Moment. We're off stage with DWP, talking about specifically what In This Moment brings, not only to a festival, but just to a live concert. And it's not four sweaty people on stage with Marshall Stacks, you know, looking at their shoes. The entertainment value of In This Moment is so important to rock and roll. I have to ask you, as you have a beautiful backdrop right now on the Zoom call, what was behind Maria's bed when you, the 13, 14 Maria, what was on your walls? I got it. Take us back to your bedroom if you can.
You actually couldn't see my walls. I covered them in like magazine pages, like all from all different types of magazines.
Like what, Cream and... In Rolling Stone, or was it?
Yes, some of them were rock and roll, some of them were pop, some of them were like editorial fashion Vogue, like the really twisted kind of like dark like editorials that you'll see, and there'd be like a whole section that do like different colors through my whole all over the whole wall. So I was definitely creative and twisted when I was a young teenager. I was all kinds of messed up in my head when I was younger, but.
So you weren't a minimalist with your bedroom. It was covered.
You couldn't see the walls. Yeah. Fabrics hanging everywhere. And I grew up with a really beautiful, like, free-spirited hippie mama. She had me really young. And I was getting, as a little girl, I was barefoot at concerts with my mom, seeing Stevie Nicks, Tina Turner, The Runaways. Like, she took me to all the concerts because she was only, like, 17 and she didn't have babysitters. So I got
Hold on, time out. Did you see, you said you saw The Runaways?
Yeah, she took me to see, I think she said I saw The Runaways with her, yes.
Wow.
I don't remember.
I don't know a lot of people who said that.
I have no memory whatsoever of that. I also saw, that's going to make my head. Piano, Elton John, and I don't remember that either. I was just so young, yeah.
That reminds me of a Duff McKagan story who... I don't know why I thought of this, who told me once that he met Sir Elton John at Live Aid. Freddie Mercury's, that famous Freddie Mercury tribute, when Metallica and Guns N' Roses and George Michael. And he goes, right. Gary, not only did I meet Elton John, he said we talked for an hour and I don't remember.
So, oh my
God. How weird is that? That's your excuse. Right. That's your excuse. His excuse is that he was so fucked up and on drugs. And you don't remember talking to somebody for an hour, but it was Sir Elton John.
Oh, no. You would want to remember that.
Right.
Yeah.
So he as he got sober and is well, it's just a marvelous path as we know Duff now. He saw Elton John again and was like, oh, it's good to see you again, mate. He's like, God, I don't remember meeting. And Elton reminded him. And there's that story. So who was it, though, on that wall? Or what rock and roll singer or band led you to the path like, well, this is what I want to do?
I think that because of my mom, like, I didn't believe actually when I was that young that I was like really going to be a rock star yet. My mom said I would like be listening to her, her Patti Smith records, and I'd be dancing on the table, and I like loved all her music, but I was just a little girl. But I think she really just inspired me with all that stuff that I got to see and listen to. And then I kind of got into my young teen and listened to all my other stuff. But I think that I started falling in love with like probably the heavier side of music, probably more as like a mid late teenager. I started getting into like Pantera and Deftones and Korn and like all of that type of world, and kind of that's where I was really like, so I grew up on all of the more classic stuff like with my mom, and then I started kind of seeing all these other different things. I also lived in upstate New York, so I also go to a lot of hardcore concerts and things like that. They'd have all over here, like we had the little club here called QE2.
So like Dillinger Escape Plan type bands and all that, or?
Yeah, like old school hardcore bands, like Hatebreed and all kinds of like old school stuff like that, and punk rock stuff too. So I used to go to like that type of stuff too when I was starting off. But
that doesn't
like
hippie mama at all.
What?
That doesn't sound like your hippie mama at all.
Mama?
Yeah, but that,
oh, my mom?
Yeah, she was like, what are you listening to? Is she Maria, is she still around?
Oh, yes. And she's actually, my mom is like my whole world. She's actually, I have a new song on the new album called Mother. And she's singing, I have two mothers, actually. My mom has a wife. And they're both singing with me on that song. So it's really sweet.
Oh, wow. That's, I didn't know that. Which is that's the name of your album.
Yes. And then that's like, we have a song that too.
Why didn't I start the interview with that? Damn.
No, that's fine.
Yeah. So with that said, new album. That's a good segue, because one thing I had written down is you are really good at collaboration. You know, there's Rob Halford with Black Wedding. There's Jacoby and Papa Roach with Gravity. You had Brent Smith with Sexual Hallucination, and lately you got Lizzie and Taylor to do We Will Rock You. Is that just because you love them, or what's behind all that? Because you have some really good collaborations.
Yeah, mostly all the people I also worked with Five Finger, and I worked with Motionless. I worked with Dead. He's on my new album, Junkatella is, and all the people I've worked with, yes, I adore. Like, they're all my friends. We adore each other, and they're all good people. And I wanted to really bring this kind of feminine empowerment in the new album, Mother. And I think that's why I wanted to ask Taylor and Lizzie. You know, they're both just so powerful and beautiful and their own queens, and they're so different from each other. And I was like, I can get these two to do this with me. This could be really special. And they both reacted so positively, and I think it was a special moment, and I can't wait someday. I don't know how we're gonna make that figure out, but we'll have to do it live together.
Oh my God. No, let's make a point. It has to start at a DWP festival. You, yes. Lizzie, okay. Taylor. I love that idea. That's another good segue. You're doing very good with me. You're making it easy. There, you have been on these, you know, female empowerment rock, hard rock tours. with Hailstorm and Lizzie, and having Dorothy, who's also a good friend of to DWP. It's one of those generic questions, but if I find it really important. Has it always been kind of a role for you? It's been a responsibility in a male-dominated genre, especially male-dominated industry, let's face it, that you carry a torch?
Well, I just thought it's always important to try to, like, lift up other women, like, even, like, our sisters, like, Butcher's Babies and New Year's Day, and, like, even back in the beginning of our career, we were, you know, playing with, like, Walls of Jericho and, like, you know, even Kitty we played with way back.
Love Kitty, so, yeah.
Yeah, like, way back. We were like, oh, my God, we're playing with Kitty. And it, so I think that it was always been important to me to try to, like, if you can collaborate with other women, maybe because you don't see it so much in that world, especially 10 years ago, I think a bit more. Now I think it's really blooming beautifully. I do think that you are hearing, you know, Pretty Reckless, you are hearing Hailstorm, you're hearing it in this moment. And I think that it is starting to, you know, come about more. I see it happening.
Okay, so you don't get frustrated that this is a real male-dominated genre, and it doesn't, or does it drive you? Because I agree with you. It is evolving, and I'm optimistic as well, but it's also right. Frustrating at the same time.
I think that, like, you just gotta, like, I believe no matter what sex you are, if you really have, like, passion and you're gonna make something happen, like, nothing's gonna stop you. Like, being a woman or being a man or being white or black, like, you're gonna make it happen. And if the music is magical and you find that something, whatever that is, you know, and you keep building up that, like, I feel like we can't let things hold us back, like because we're being held back. I really try to look at it like women are empowering themselves right now in this scene, and you're seeing it kind of blooming and happening. And so I try to look at it from a positive point of view.
Good, good. Please don't stop, because it's getting better. And we, yes. At DWP, we want to make sure, you know, there's those and watchdog websites when we announce a festival that will, and they'll send us percentages of how many ladies we have on our ad mat. But at the same time, we're not just, we can't put on bands or music that sucks. Fortunately, because of you and Hailstorm and Pretty Reckless, like you said, and New Year's Day, Butcher Babies, there's some compelling music with women in our scene, and it's that's where I'm optimistic too.
Right. I think that there's a lot of powerful women right now out there who are setting beautiful examples to all the women that if this is what they want to accomplish, they 100% can do it. Like, nothing's holding them back. Just do it. So I think that's
yeah. And a special shout out to Amy Lee of Evanescence, one of the drivers.
Amy Coyle. I mean, there's so many powerful, beautiful women, like, in this scene, like, you know what I mean? Yeah. There's just so many powerful powerhouses, like, showing different, you know, different avenues and showing women that if they want to do it, they can. Anybody can do anything they want to do if they just really put their mind to it.
What's, out of all the collaborations you've done, from Five Finger to Papa Roach to Brent Smith and Rob Halford, what's the one that stands out where you're most proud of?
Oh gosh, that's a hard one.
Sorry.
I don't know. I have different favorites for all of them. I'll pick my mom's, because my collaborations with my mother's from my song Mother.
Smart answer.
Like, Ivan is my dear friend. He's like my brother. I love Ivan so much. Joe is my love from Dead, so of course that's special to me. My two queens I'm doing with Lizzie and Led, that's so special to me. And Wild House, I mean, all of them. Sunny, I mean, Chris Motionless, these are like my friends, all of them. So
yeah, there was a really nice moment that myself and Danny Wimmer had with you guys. It was backstage at the Golden God Awards in Los Angeles. It was right after an Aftershock weekend, and at Golden God, you guys did your duet. You did the song with Rob Halford. Was that like, again, I'm just trying to imagine the 14-year-old Maria with everything covered in her in her bedroom, and now you're on stage with one of the true icon gods of metal. That's, if you talk to your 14-year-old self, what would you say to that?
I mean, it was such an honor. It was like, you know, those are one of those moments, like you have like specific moments through your career where like things happen and it's special. And we knew we were going to do the song together, and that was like really special. And then we did a music video together, and that was like a whole other special. And then we, like you said, we got to do it live together. I mean, I don't get nervous a lot either anymore. I'm pretty like, I can go out in the giant crowds. I get more empowered when I walk on stage than I do get nervous. I don't get shaky or like, oh God. I get more like, I tap into something. But I was a little nervous going up with him that day. But yeah, he's so cool and kind.
Why wouldn't you be? But you're right. He is like a super sweet man.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. He's like a really good, humble man.
And like Sir Elton John, he's a fan too. He devours new music, and that's love seeing that. Yeah.
Yeah, that's how we met him. He came to one of our shows, and they were like, "He'd like to say hi." And we're like, "What?" You know? Uh-huh. So, I guess we can.
Right. So hey, we're off stage with DWP Maria. We've reached kind of the end of this. Is there any message that you like to give all to the In This Moment fans and all Maria's fans out there, as we're unfortunately not able to see them in person?
Yes, there is. Just a few things. Thank you to everyone, because our album came out right as, you know, the coronavirus dropped. So thank you to everyone that's been really like being in touch with the music and connecting with us over, you know, from a distance. And just everyone to be safe, you know, all this tragedy that we've had with the virus, just take care of yourselves, take care of each other, be safe, wear your masks. And
wear masks,
yes. And just everything else in the world, be kind to each other. Just all these politics and all the heartbreak and pain going on in the world, just for people to just be kind to each other and love each other and just peace and love. Like, that's my advice. And I love you guys. Thank you for your support. We just adore you. We cannot wait. I'm going to be happy crying when we're all live playing again at a live show. Like, and I'm just, it's going to happen, and I can't wait. But thank you so much.
Okay. And everybody, we'll see you on the other side when we all get out of this. Thank you for watching Offstage with DWP. Please tell Chris and the whole band we said hello. Special shout out to Tony Couch, our good buddy. And we love you, Maria.
We love you guys. We'll see you soon.
Okay.
Bye.